All right, welcome everyone who's tuning in on Facebook. It's 7 o'clock now, so we're gonna get started here. We have a packed hour and 15 minutes for folks here. Though I'm figuring out how to not share my screen anymore. Oh, it's only my 27,000th one of these. So welcome everyone who's following along on Facebook. Tonight we're gonna make sure that folks who are currently renting during the crisis know what their rights are. Our office has gotten a lot of questions about what does the Pennsylvania eviction moratorium mean? What does the new order issued by the CDC mean? What does it look like to go through an eviction proceeding? How do I find rent relief and sign up for that program? So we're getting all these questions, and rightfully so. In the 21st District, the area that I represent, and we have about 41% of our households live in rental units, and about half of those folks make under $40,000 a year. So that's less than the median income in the county, and oftentimes that means that folks are living paycheck to paycheck. And when something like this unexpected crisis comes, of course, people are going to have a hard time paying rent. And, you know, while moratoriums keep people housed temporarily, we've put the burden a lot on our small mom and pop landlords. We've asked them to be essentially human services and a social safety net that they're not equipped to be either. So there's a lot of work that we're doing on a state level to make sure our rental relief program gets funds out more quickly and that there's less bureaucracy involved. We're working on bills to make sure that if you do have to go through eviction proceedings, that you have the right to counsel. And different things that can support folks during this crisis. But legislation typically takes a longer time and people need some answers now and need some clarity now. So that's why I'm so excited to have the lineup of folks that we have with us this evening. We have, three experts. We have someone who's a magisterial justice. We have a housing lawyer, and then someone who actually works directly with providing services to folks. So this evening, you're gonna hear from all three of them, and then we're gonna save some time for some Q&A. So the folks that are on the Zoom call, you'll just wanna make sure that you're muted. And if you have any questions during the presentations, at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a little talk bubble that says chat. You can go ahead and click on that and type in your question there. For folks that are following along on Facebook, feel free to type in the comments section what your questions are. And when we get to that section, we will look at them and pose them to our panelists as well as myself. So that's all the housekeeping I have right now. So let's get into it. First up, we have the Honorable Mick Pappas. He represents the 31st Magisterial District, which is primarily in Pittsburgh's East End. And he's gonna spend some time with us this evening explaining kind of what an eviction process looks like from the perspective of someone who serves in that position and kind of how you can be informed if you find yourself going through that process. So welcome, Mick. I'm gonna have you unmute yourself and we look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Okay, and thank you very much for having me, Representative Innamorato. It's really a pleasure to be with you tonight and with folks who know much more than me about evictions. There is a lot to say about what's happening right now with evictions in the country and Allegheny County specifically, with people's housing stability, with income from landlords. It's all been affected by first the CARES Act, then orders from our Supreme Court here in Pennsylvania, then orders from our local courts here in Allegheny County, then orders from our governor, Tom Wolf. And it's been a shifting landscape in terms of the legal landscape for months. And it's been difficult to keep up even for judges and attorneys and experts in the law. So it is not uncommon, and it's certainly okay to be uncertain about your housing future, your income future, if you're a landlord, especially mom and pops who don't have, you know, lawyers on call at the time to explain them what's happening. But the good news is that it looks like with the new CDC order, Center for Disease Control order, which Attorney Dame was going to speak about more, and the orders that our local Fifth Judicial District has set forth in light of the CDC order, we're going to get some clarity, and it's going to last for a little bit longer. So I think that's what we're here to do tonight, is kind of explain what the current framework is and what people can expect if they have a dispute with their landlord, or if they're a landlord, they have a dispute with their tenant. I guess the first thing I would say is that people should go to the Fifth Judicial District website and look up our new emergency order issued under President Judge Kim Clark. It describes what the procedures are and how they've changed when going to court in front of magistrate district judges and in common police court in Allegheny County in light of the CDC order. I would certainly suggest going to the Fifth Judicial District website and looking up these new emergency orders. I would also suggest reaching out to your district court for guidance. They can't give you legal advice, but they can give you some sense of what the procedure will look like. If you get a notice to quit, which is the first step in setting forth a legal process for eviction, recovery of a rental unit. If you get a notice to quit, it should contain the grounds for your landlord wanting to recover the property. And a landlord should know that they have to state very specifically what the grounds are. Was the lease breached in some way and how? It has to be provided a certain period of time before any case is filed. And that is all unless the notice to quit was waived. So what people typically understand is an eviction notice under the law is called a notice to quit. It's a procedural requirement. The court doesn't have jurisdiction to hear a case if that requirement's not met, but that requirement can be waived in the lease. So know whether your lease waived the notice to quit requirement. And if you do receive it, either contact somebody for legal advice or contact the court to understand what your next steps are going to be. Procedures are going to be different, and I want to get into that a little bit more later after Mr. Damewood has a chance to present about the CDC order in more length. But people can be rest assured that there is an abundance of supports in place since the pandemic began. The Pittsburgh area has increased its capacity to prevent evictions 100-fold. There's public subsidy available. There's Rent Help PGH available, which Ms. Lacombe will speak to. There is government funds available through CARES Rent Relief. There's mediation available. Just all these resources that weren't there before, and people should feel rest assured, whether they're a landlord or a tenant, that they will be supported through the process.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for providing that update and really giving some folks some clarity on what to expect and some, as well as some helpful advice on what to do to get some more information. Next up, we have Bob Damewood. He is a staff attorney at Regional Housing Legal Services. Bob and I have worked together closely on some of the housing policy that our office has put out, and he's been very active and helpful during this time, and really helping to provide clarity to both landlords and tenants alike on what to expect and how to navigate this space. So welcome, Bob. Thank you so much for being here this evening. And I believe you have some slides to share.
Yes. Thank you, Representative Innamorato. Thank you for the kind words. Yes, so like Representative Innamorato said, my name is Bob Damewood. I'm a staff attorney in the Pittsburgh Office of Regional Housing Legal Services. We are a statewide specialty legal aid program. We represent community-based nonprofit organizations and occasionally tenant organizations that are engaged in housing development or community development transactions. And we also we also engage in policy advocacy on behalf of low-income Pennsylvanians. So as Judge Pappas said, we've been in a shifting landscape, and so the latest change dropped about a little over a week ago. So September 1st, the Centers for Disease Control issued an order, a nationwide order, creating a temporary halt to evictions. It halts certain evictions through December 31st. And in order to qualify, a tenant must sign a declaration, and I'll go into the declaration later. There's a URL, there's a link to the declaration at the bottom of the slide. I believe these slides will be made available, and I could also put it into a chat if that would help. Anyway, the tenant must sign a declaration, deliver that declaration to their landlord, or provide it to the court, or provide proof that the declaration was given to their landlord to the court. So this can be done proactively by signing a declaration, giving it to your landlord now before anything is filed, or it can be done, reactively if a tenant receives a complaint, an eviction complaint, then proof that then the tenant can provide this declaration to the landlord or to the court, or just provide the court with proof that the tenant has provided the declaration to the landlord. And so what that will do is it will stay certain evictions. Essentially, all evictions are stayed. If a tenant provides that declaration, signs that declaration, all evictions are halted, except the ones in the following list. So evictions for criminal activity on the premises, evictions for health and safety, threatening the health and safety of other residents, damaging property, violating some building code or health ordinance or other health and safety regulation, or lease violations that are other than non-payment of rent. So those are accepted, but evictions that don't fall into those categories are halted once that declaration is delivered. Okay, and what does that mean? What does it mean when I say that evictions are halted? Essentially, the CDC order is directed at landlords, and it provides criminal penalties against landlords who violate it. So if a signed declaration is provided to the landlord, then the landlord may not take any action to remove or to cause the removal of a tenant household. Now, that's not defined anywhere. So there's more than one way to interpret that. But I think the most likely interpretation is if an action is necessary to remove the tenant. So if the tenant can't be removed, but for an action that the landlord takes, such as giving a notice to quit, such as filing an eviction action, such as moving, if there's already pending proceeding, taking any affirmative step to move that proceeding along. I mean, those are, applying for a writ of possession. Those are actions that would be barred under the CDC order. If a landlord takes any of those actions, they are potentially subject to a fine of up to $100,000. If they take one of those actions and it results in death, the fine is higher, or it could be imprisonment of up to 1 year. And then in addition to providing, the declaration to the landlord, if the declaration is given to the court, or if the court becomes aware that the declaration was provided to the landlord, eviction proceedings will be stayed through the end of the year until at least January 1st. So what is in the declaration? So the declaration is a sworn statement. It's not sworn, but it's a statement under penalty of perjury that a tenant makes. And there are five elements to it. The first is that the tenant has used best efforts to obtain all available government assistance for rent or housing. So basically, when you sign the statement, you know, one of the things you're saying is that you've applied for rental assistance. So apply for rental assistance before signing the statement, if you haven't already. Best efforts, it doesn't mean you have to do everything under the sun. It means doing everything that you can reasonably be expected to do. So if there's three different, like in Allegheny County, three different pots of government assistance for rental assistance, you don't have to apply to each one. You apply to the one that makes the most sense for you. And as long as you reasonably believe that you're eligible for rental assistance, you'll be fine. So this doesn't mean, best efforts means doing everything that you can reasonably be expected to do. Okay, the second part of the declaration, there's income limits that you attest to. So basically the tenant's income has to be less than $99,000 a year, $198,000 if filing jointly, there's a couple other ways of meeting that income requirement, but that's basically the highest one. That's one thing that the tenant is attesting to. A third thing, the tenant is unable to pay full rent due to a substantial loss of income, a loss of work hours or wages, layoffs, or extraordinary medical expenses. So unlike the rental relief program, a loss of income doesn't have to be tied to COVID. If a tenant has suffered a loss of income that makes it, that means that the tenant is no longer able to pay their full rent, it doesn't have to be because of COVID. It can be something that happened before March 1st, right? This is a little bit broader than the rent relief program in that respect. But there has to be some sort of, loss of income or extraordinary medical expenses that make it impossible to pay the full rent. Substantial loss of income is not defined. So there's no minimum like percentage loss of income or anything like that. Extraordinary medical expenses is, and it's pretty high. It's 7.5% of household income, which is a pretty high standard. Okay, four, the tenant is using best efforts, there's best efforts again, to make timely partial payments that are as close to the full payment as the tenant's circumstances permit. So again, best efforts means doing everything you can reasonably be expected to do. Tenants should definitely make partial payments. Offer your landlord partial payments. You know your circumstances better than anybody else. You know your income and your expenses. You know, best efforts does not mean you have to starve your kids. It doesn't mean your children have to go without necessaries. It doesn't mean you have to dip into your retirement, right? Best efforts only means reasonable efforts, everything you can reasonably be expected to do. But you should, if you're going to sign this declaration, look at your expenses, look at your income, and offer a payment that you can make. I mean, don't offer something that you can't live up to, but offer, the best payment that you have the ability to make. And then finally, the last statement in the declaration, if evicted, the tenant would likely become homeless or live with other people in close quarters because the tenant has no other available housing options. And what available housing means housing that you can afford that's decent, safe, and sanitary. So that meets code, right? You don't have to accept, it doesn't mean you have to, move into unsafe or unsanitary housing. And it doesn't mean you have to pay more than the rent that you already can't afford to pay. So those are the parts of the declaration, the statements made in the declaration, and the tenant is making those statements under penalties of perjury. But again, the best efforts standard is don't be scared by that. Just be reasonable. And then finally, a little bit of practical advice, and I've already said a couple of these things, but keep a copy of your signed declaration. Don't give your landlord the only copy, because you know you're gonna have to show that at some point that you gave your declaration to your landlord. Be able to prove delivery, to your landlord. So you could do that by first class mail. If you go to the post office and request verification of delivery, they can do that. Or you could do that by taking a photo of it and texting it to your landlord or emailing it to your landlord. Those are acceptable methods of delivery, and those methods allow you to show when you delivered that declaration to your landlord. That's my advice. Be able to prove in court that you gave your landlord this declaration. Apply for rental assistance first before signing the declaration, because that's one of the statements. You have to say that you've used reasonable or best efforts to apply for rental assistance. Offer your landlord at least some partial payment, and be prepared, in case this declaration is challenged in court, you're going to need to be prepared to show that the elements of the declaration are true. So be prepared to show your income, your expenses, and your loss of income, just in case it's challenged. And with that, that's all I have. I'd be glad to answer any questions, or anyone can send me an email at bob@rhls.org. And with that, I will stop sharing the screen and turn it back to Representative Innamorato.
Great. Thank you so much, Bob. You figured that out much more quickly than I did at the beginning. Thank you so much for that information. It's a lot to digest. So just a reminder, if people have questions, don't be shy. You can put it in the chat. We have about 25 people or so tuning in on Facebook, so feel free to comment with your question or, message us, and, we'll be moving to a Q&A after our last presenter. And with that, our last presenter for this evening is Abby Ray Lacombe, and she is the program director at Rent Help PGH. If you have been to a community meeting in one of the East End neighborhoods in Pittsburgh, you have probably seen Abby's smiling and reassuring face. She's been very active in the community for quite some time, and now is in what I think is the perfect position in helping connect people to resources, because she has lived and breathed this work for quite some time. So we're so excited for her to share her knowledge with us this evening. So welcome, Abby.
Well, thank you, Representative Innamorato. Those were very nice words. Thanks. Hi, everybody. I am Abby Ray. I'm the program director at Rent Help PGH. We are a new and launching organization attempting to bring the myriad services available to us to a central location. And Representative Innamorato asked me to be here tonight to talk with you guys a little bit about the programs and organizations that are available to people in need right now. I will start. Am I doing it? Can you see it?
Not.
Help me, Sarah. No, don't. I'll figure it out. See?
Beautiful. I'm
figuring it out.
There it is. Fantastic.
Yay. First, I want to run through a handful of the programs that are available to you right now, especially if you are in arrears with your rent. These will be very brief overviews. As Representative Innamorato said, if you have questions, please definitely throw them at me at the end. And then I want to introduce you to a handful of organizations that are available. This is a smidge of the amazing organizations that we have in Allegheny County, but some that are very pertinent to our conversations right now. So our first program is CARES RRP. That's the CARES Rent Relief Program. I'm sure many of you have heard of it. It is quite the buzz right now. It offers up to $750 a month for 6 months between March and December of 2020. If you have lost at least 30% of your income or had a decline of at least 30% of your income since March 1st, and you are 30 days behind in your rent. Along with the $750 a month that is provided by the CARES RRP, which is from the General Assembly, we also have Allegheny County rent funds that are applied for with the same application. So it's a really wonderful application for one stone and up to three birds, because Allegheny County also set aside funding to support back utility payments. So if you have fallen behind on your electric, gas, if you have accrued any court fees due to eviction processes, this application can help you access those funds as well. A really important thing to know about CARES RRP is that the application is rather arduous and can potentially take a lot of time. There is a lot of supplemental documentation that is required. Allegheny County has issued a one-pager to walk you through that documentation. And I will make sure that Representative Innamorato has that to share with you all. Another important factor for CARES RRP is that the application deadline is September 30th. And so that is in 20 days. In our experience at Rep and Help PGH, it takes in between 5 and 10 days to gather all of the documentation. So if you have fallen behind on your rent in September, or you've been paying partial rents at any point throughout the year, you really want to get started on this application as soon as possible. We will make sure that you have access to the online application through Representative Innamorato. And again, I'm glad to answer any questions that you might have. Another good program that is unfortunately only available to Pittsburgh residents is the Housing Stabilization Program. Key gateways for this program is that you must have a valid lease and you must live in the city of Pittsburgh proper, not in a borough. And you must be currently employed. If you can check those boxes and your landlord is up to date on their property taxes, then you can get up to $3,000 for back rent or utilities, or 3 months of back rent utilities, up to $3,000. You can also use HSP to cover first and last month or security deposit if you are moving to a new place. To access this program, you do just call 211. When you call 211, be as honest about your situation always as possible. There are always a series of questions to vet your eligibility for not just the program you think you're calling about, but many others. So you want to be as forthright as you can to each question that they ask. Are you a vet? Do you have a disability? Are you a single parent? Are you a student? Like, we really want you to emphasize each characteristic that sets you apart. We also have a COVID-19 HSP that sometimes is called CDBG. Again, you still need to live in Pittsburgh proper and you need to have a valid lease. And you also must be able to show that you've lost income or your job due to COVID-19. A nice thing about COVID-19 HSP is you do not have to currently have a job to apply for it. Your landlord still must be up to date on their property taxes. But again, it is $3,000 or 3 months for back rent and utilities. And it can also cover first and last month and or a security deposit. And it is also going to be accessed through 211. Right now we have an eviction prevention program that again requires Pittsburgh proper and a valid lease. If you are being evicted, and this can be at any stage in the eviction process, so long as you have a docket number, they can provide up to $3,000 in an arrears settlement, so paying your back rent, or supersedious payments. One thing to note about eviction prevention program is that your landlord will be required to settle. So that means working out with you how we are going to get all of the back rent paid, or agree to a number that we are going to pay off. The landlord must cease their eviction process, therefore, but they are able to reinstate it down the line. This is not a long-term call off from the landlord. This program is also accessed through 211. Some things to know about these three programs is that you cannot earn more than 50% of either AMI or federal poverty. I can't remember off the top of my head, but those numbers look like this for 2020. So if your income is above these numbers, neither HSP, COVID-19 HSP or EPP will work for you. Another great organization I want to call your attention to is Neighborhood Legal Services. They have two help desk lines that you can call. They are open Monday through Friday, 9 to 1. They will start with just getting to know a little bit about your situation, and you will either receive some legal advice over the phone, some guidance on how to handle your hearing, what you should say, what you should emphasize. And it's possible that they will assign you to representation from a lawyer. Just Mediation Pittsburgh is a newer organization for us in Pittsburgh. You apply to work with them online. This is for folks whose landlords typically want to work with you. If you've historically had a good relationship and now it's getting harder and harder to communicate, Just Mediation can be a really great option. Both the landlord or the tenant can initiate the engagement. Mediation typically lasts between an hour and a half, 2 hours. And what you are going to be focusing on is avoiding eviction. So what kind of agreement can we come to get back on a solid level together? So do we need to get applications in for various rental assistance programs? Do we need to set up a payment plan? A mediator at Just Mediation Pittsburgh will be able to assist you guys in finding an agreement that suits both of your needs. Another organization that I think everyone should have on their radar is PUR, the Pittsburgh Union of Regional Renters. They also have a help desk line, 412-444-8497. One of the most important things I think I can call your attention to about PUR is if you are not being evicted now, but it comes to you a few weeks down the line, PUR will be able to give you very, very quick reminders of your next steps. So much of what Bob just reviewed in his slides, PUR will coach you through. So we want to make sure that we get the declaration signed, delivered to the landlord. You need to show up at the hearing, and they will just walk through with that so that while you are experiencing a very traumatic time, you have a very calm ally to help you stay focused and get through it. They also do tenant organizing, and at times they will do direct actions and community defense. So if you have a landlord who is attempting a self-help eviction, which means coming and changing your locks without legal warrant, PUR is a great organization to call. There are volunteers all over Allegheny County who will gather to assist in diverting the landlord's attention. Finally, Rent Help PGH, which is my home base. We offer connection with resource navigation by way of connecting you with a resource navigator. In particular, we are working with people who are actively facing eviction or rehousing situations. And we have a help desk, 412-534-6600, as well as a Spanish-speaking help desk. Through the help desk, you will get screened. And more importantly, we're going to have an in-depth conversation with you and try to get an idea of what your needs are. We do not exclusively work with people who are facing rental issues. We will talk with you medical, therapy, social services, difficulty with your kids in remote schooling. You can bring anything to the help desk, and we are going to try our hardest to connect you with services that can assist you right then. If we see that your situation is going to be longer lasting, we will try to get you connected with a resource navigator as quickly as we are able. And the last one I want to draw your attention to, this isn't really one you can call. I just want you to know it's there because we have a lot of superheroes in Allegheny County. And one of our superheroes has launched Eviction Rapid Response. And there are quite a few people involved in keeping track of the current eviction cases and reaching out to those tenants by phone call, text message, mailer, seeing if we can find them on Facebook, and even having volunteers outside of the magistrate's offices to ensure that people know that these declarations exist right now. And that this is an avenue that is available to them. I think that's the last slide. It is. Don't worry, I'm gonna figure it out, you guys. Stop share.
Very good. Thank you so much. So we have a couple questions that have come in. So I'm gonna just read some of them, and then you know, whoever wants to chime in can, and we'll use the rest of the time together just to address some of those concerns that folks who have been following along have, and we'll make sure that everyone who registered, we will send out the resources that we have. If you didn't get a chance to register using the Zoom link and you're following along on Facebook, feel free to message us. You will get an automatic response with our office's email address. It's refinnamorato@pahouse.net, and we will make sure that you get the resources that we discussed here this evening. So our first question, let me just look at the chat real quick. And so we've had a lot of different orders that have come down from the federal government to the state to even the county level. So Bob, can you address whether the CARES Act still provides protections, or have they been superseded by this other federal mandate?
Sure. Well, so, you know, the CARES Act had kind of a moratorium that expired, had a moratorium on evictions from federally assisted properties. So properties with federal subsidies or with a federally backed mortgage, you know, FHA, VA, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac. That expired July 31st, but there are a couple provisions that are still in effect. One is if your landlord has, you know, that kind of federal assistance, right, or federal subsidy or federally backed mortgage, you can only, the landlord must give a 30-day notice to quit before filing for eviction. So that's whether it's waived in the lease, that's whether, you know, there's a shorter notice period under Pennsylvania law, that doesn't matter. If your landlord, if you're in one of those covered properties with that, you know, federal subsidy or federally backed mortgage, your landlord has to give you a 30-day notice. The second thing is, and this is really hard to find out, but if your landlord has a federally backed mortgage and it's in forbearance, one of the things that the CARES Act provided is homeowners and other property owners with federally backed mortgages have the right to ask for forbearance up to a year. But for multifamily property owners, if their mortgage is in forbearance, the moratorium still applies. They can't evict for non-payment of rent while that property is in forbearance. And so even after this CDC order expires at the end of the year, you should try to figure out, you know, whether your landlord, and realistically, you know, lawyers can figure this out probably better than tenants can, but you know, try to figure out whether your landlord has a federally backed mortgage and whether it's in forbearance, because then, you know, there might still be a moratorium that applies after the CDC order expires.
Bob, where would we go to look up whether your landlord has a federally backed mortgage? I think that there's a couple databases online.
There are. So the National Low Income Housing Coalition has a database. I mean, the databases aren't 100% accurate, but they'll give you an idea. Mm-hmm. But that's one place to go. So National Low Income Housing Coalition, so you could try that. You can also call Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and ask them. So if you go to their website, they have like a lookup tool. They have a mortgage lookup tool that either landlords can use to find out, you know, the property owners can use this electronic lookup tool, or there's a phone number that can that you can call to find out. And that's, I don't have it, I'm sorry, but it's on their website.
We can look it up and we can send it in the follow-up email to folks as a resource. And I mean, oftentimes, like, as this was the first home that I purchased, so I know that I have an FHA back mortgage because I participated in that program. So, you know, if you are a first-time homeowner, I know that's not necessarily renting, but if you're having issues paying your mortgage, then you might have chosen to participate in an FHA-backed mortgage. Abby, I have a question for you. So it's Rent Out PGH. I know we have a lot of folks tuning in here that are outside of the city limits and in the county. So specifically, I think we have our friends in Millville and in Sharpsburg who are tuning in this evening. Would you be able to help them navigate and connect to some resources that are countywide?
Yes, absolutely. PGH in the broader sense. We serve all of Allegheny County. And the truth is, I'm a sucker. And so the help desk also serves all of Pennsylvania to the greatest extent that we are able.
Oh,
because I really like everybody. Yeah. I do want to also bring up real quick that it looked like Judge Pappas had a piggyback on what Bob was saying. You had your hand up or your finger up for a second there.
Oh, sure.
Sorry.
Oh, thanks, Abby Ray. I was just going to add that the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania issued a affidavit. It's a CARES Act affidavit that a landlord has to file at the time of filing complaint. And so a portion of that affidavit still applies and will still have to be provided upon filing with respect to the provisions that Attorney Damewood mentioned. So keep that in mind. You know, whenever things are being filed in court from the landlord side of things, there's a number of things that you're going to have to sign in terms of affidavits, including CARES Act and CDC declaration affidavits.
Great, thank you for that clarity. We've used a little bit of legalese this evening and things that I know that I'm not naturally disposed to know the definition of. So when we talked about this new CDC eviction moratorium, we talked a lot about a declaration and delivering that to the landlord. Is there some place that people can go that they can get a template? Because I know I wouldn't know the first thing about writing one of those if I was left to my own devices. So are there resources where folks can look up what that would look like?
I can follow up on that quickly. Many of those forms are going to be mailed out with any complaints and scheduling notices from a court. So the CDC declaration, if it's not already provided at the time of filing, affidavits, if they're not already provided at the time of filing, will be mailed out. At least in our court, I know many others are going to be doing this, with the materials that you typically find when you get notice of a landlord-tenant case, which is the complaint and hearing notice. So some of these supplemental materials will be provided at the time of filing or at the time of notice from the court of the case. And then at the time of the first hearing, which will serve as a status conference instead of a trial, which is one of the new procedures that we have here, this will also be an opportunity either be presented with the first time with these documents or to submit them to the court. So really it's kind of the first hearing is kind of like this status conference where we're not holding a trial. We're figuring out which, if any of these, the CDC program, the rent assistance program through County CARES, which apply and how the case should proceed. And folks should know also that usually a case in landlord-tenant court in front of an MDJ has to be decided within 30 days. That's what the rules of procedure usually require. But if the CDC order applies, the case would be stayed for up until the end of the year. And even if it doesn't apply, the court has a lot of leeway now through our countywide court order to work with the case until an application for rent assistance, until there's an outcome on that application. So time is not of the essence as much as it had been pre-COVID. You'll have time to work with the other party in the courts.
And let me add, first of all, I think that's wonderful. It seems to me that that is a real shift in the way magistrates hear eviction matters. But it just seems more like a conciliatory process and less like a hearing. And I just think that's wonderful. As far as the question, where do you find the declaration? Rent Help PGH has it on their website. And I included the link in the chat. So hopefully folks can see that. I know folks in Zoom can see it. Hopefully folks on Facebook Live can see it as well. But I'm sure Representative Innamorato can get that out.
And I'll add on to that, that if in 3 weeks this becomes a concern for you, if it comes up and you're like, where can I find that? You can always call Rent Help PGH and we will send it to you per as well. So per, remember that, or Rent Help PGH, remember that. And if this comes up in a few weeks, reach out to one of us and we will send it to you.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, thank you. And I do have to say thanks so much to Anne, who I know is watching on Facebook, and she is posting all of the links to things. So Anne, we're so grateful for you and your support of providing support services for this presentation in the form of comments on Facebook. Ms. Carroll was asking you, Abby, if you could clarify the income levels again. She's getting some questions from people and they want to make sure that they meet the requirements to participate. So I don't know if you want to pop those up again on your screen.
The fun answer, as many of us know, is that the income levels vary based on the program. Mm-hmm. So Rent Help PGH has income levels. Oh, I did it wrong. Sorry, guys. Don't worry. It won't take me as long this time. Rent Help PGH has income levels that are 250% of federal poverty guidelines. These numbers come from the URA. These programs, HSP, COVID-19, HSP, and Eviction Prevention Program or URA programs, their cap is 50% of either AMI or federal poverty. What I really want, and in fact, CARES has an income level that your household can't be over 100% of AMI. I don't want you as a person applying for programs to get too bogged down in that. That's what we as resource navigators are here for. I don't want you to hear those numbers and get intimidated, like, what if it's not me? Because if you don't qualify for a 50% program, there is something out there that we can connect you with. It's more important, recognize that you have the need, recognize that you want help, and reach out to us. We will work with you. We will find something to assist you. Ms. Carroll, does that answer your question?
She asked on Facebook, so awesome. Yeah, I think that's always the case. Like, don't get bogged down in the details. That's why we're putting these supports in place to make it easier for folks to navigate, because oftentimes when we're dealing with bureaucracy, it's written in a language that none of us speak fluently. So that's why we have these resources in place so that we can help folks. And I just want to always say, like, there's no shame in asking for help. That's why these systems exist. We are all in this together. And that's, you know, that's why these supports exist. And that's why we're here today. And did get another question on Facebook from Jennifer. And she asked, what if you're not behind on rent, but it's an extreme burden to pay? Is it possible to apply for any of these for the future?
If I jump in really quickly, speak with your landlord about withholding some of your rent right now, and you can apply for CARES. Like, if you can see that this end is coming, that you have stretched your savings to their limit, and while, you know, September, you can spend your last dollar on rent, but you don't know what you're going to be able to do in October. Really engage in a conversation with your landlord, and as quickly as possible, because again, the deadline for the CARES RRP is September 30th.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Bob.
In
a housing opportunity.
Sorry, I wasn't sure if I could unmute myself quick enough. But so in addition to that, you know, as you know, Representative, there are legislative changes in the works, and one of those changes would be to remove this 30-day delinquent requirement for the rental relief program. And so if that happens, well, and the you know, application deadline would be extended until the end of October. So if that happens, then you wouldn't have to, you know, show that you're 30 days delinquent in order to qualify for the assistance.
Ms. Carroll had chimed in of Housing Opportunity Fund as well. And we are all hitting on CARES RRP so heavily right now because it is a large pot of money and it has a very short deadline and it will do a lot for a lot of people, but it is in no way the only pot of money. So if come a month or two from now, you are falling behind, there are other programs out there to assist you. And again, for everyone outside of Pittsburgh proper, there are programs for Allegheny countywide as well. And I wanna say, like, I've been very impressed with Allegheny County throughout this whole process. They are really, really trying to open up more avenues to access for support. And I'm really proud of all of my colleagues who are continually lobbying Allegheny County to get more pots of funding available for the greater county.
Judge, did you have anything to add to that? I don't think so. No, thank you. And I think that kind of speaks to, you know, unfortunately, the way that we design services is that you can access services typically when you're in crisis. And there are few services that exist when you're noticing the symptoms, right? And if we were medical professionals, we would say, you know, go to your doctor as early as possible to get those treated, because it's always easier to be able to treat something when it's in its early stages than when you're in crisis. And unfortunately, a lot of the programs that we have historically designed have been directed to people who are in crisis. And so, you know, part of this modification of the rent relief program is saying, like, we know the early warning signs when people aren't getting unemployment, or maybe their unemployment is running out for a lot of folks. And we want to make sure that you don't have to be 30 days delinquent. It's also better for our small property owners, because they don't have to make sure they forego, you know, rent for the shorter, we want to make sure they forego rent payments for the shortest time possible, because there are many folks that I know are, you know, this is their retirement savings, or it's something that, you know, they're, you know, it's a, they own one property and they don't have a lot of resources either. And I think the judge wanted to add something.
Thanks, Sarah. I want to really emphasize that even if you don't fit into any of these programs, even if you fit into all of them, mediation is always a great option. And I know that some of the, you know, most reliable tenants out there, some of the most reliable landlords out there are already like trained mediators. But the program that's being offered here in Pittsburgh now is pairing up expert mediators, many of them already attorneys, with folks in the community. And you don't just get a chance to sit down and understand concepts like unmet needs and work out a resolution that might even improve the relationship long-term, you're going to develop skills that are then transferable to almost any aspect of your life, which is how to resolve things amicably with folks, understand each other's sides in a mediation discourse. So I really recommend it. If you're skeptical about mediation, there's nothing to it but to do it. You just got to try it. And I think that you'll enjoy the outcomes.
That actually leads into another question that I have. So would mediation be something that you would use, for example, with the rent relief program? It involves two parties to participate. So a complete application needs to be submitted by the tenant and the other part needs to be submitted by the landlord. What if you find yourself in a scenario where you're the renter and the landlord refuses to participate and complete their paperwork, or you have someone, a tenant that hasn't been paying rent and you've been a proactive landlord and you're not getting the resources you need from the tenant to be able to sign up and participate in that program? What would that look like in this scenario?
That's a really good question. Now, my understanding is that Just Mediation Pittsburgh, the mediators are kind of, in addition to being expert mediators, are being trained in helping folks apply for this process or are connecting them with resource navigators who are trained in doing that. But in the case where a landlord or a tenant is refusing to participate in one of the programs, it's similar with mediation. Mediation is by nature consented to by all sides. It has to be because the resolution is something that all the sides reach, not the mediator. The mediator doesn't tell you what the outcome is. The parties decide what it is. So it's by nature something that everybody to a dispute consents to. But if you contact Just Mediation Pittsburgh, they can help you reach out to your landlord and explain it to them, or reach out to your tenant and explain it to them in a way where they might be persuaded to participate.
Great. Does any Abby or Bob, do you want to add on to that? And we're almost at the top of the hour, but I am going to do one last call for questions on Facebook and in the chat. And then I'm going to ask the last question that I have for all of you experts. So what if we don't have, I think Bob, you had mentioned this in your presentation about having like clean and safe housing. So what if we have a scenario where someone is living in a unit where there hasn't been proper upkeep and there's potentially unsafe living conditions like mold or a leaky roof, that those repairs have gone unaddressed. And now the tenant finds themselves in a position where they can't pay rent. Maybe they were, despite having those, that being the living circumstance. What would kind of happen in that case?
Okay, well,
ending on a doozy.
there is rent withholding. And I know if the tenant can't pay rent, it still makes sense to notify your landlord about the problem and link those two things. If you could pay half your rent, but there's a serious health problem, maybe you say, I'm not going to pay any rent until this is resolved. Give your landlord a reasonable time to resolve it, but withhold, what you can. There's also, you can contact the health department and ask them to come inspect and, require the landlord to remediate the problem. There is self-help. There is a repair and deduct remedy. And again, if you can afford some rent, and if the problem is something that can be that can be repaired, like if you can set aside your rent money and then make your own repairs with that rent money, You know, if your landlord doesn't repair it, then that's an option as well. You know, I'm sorry, there's no silver bullet. There's no one answer. And it really comes down to individual circumstances. I'd be glad to talk to anybody who, you know, who would like to ask about their specific issue.
If I can follow up on what Bob said, and I'm not a lawyer, so take what I'm saying with this much, but it's my understanding that if you do go with withholding, give your notice to your landlord in writing. Do not spend the rent money that you are not giving them. Put it in an account, because if they do end up taking you to a magistrate, it's my understanding that your case will have more validity if the judge can see I wasn't just throwing my money away. I literally am living in unsafe conditions and I'm withholding it until it's fixed. And with any of these situations, I would really recommend, like, reach out to Rent Help PGH so that we can connect you with someone at Neighborhood Legal Services, or get Bob's insight on the situation. We are also under the umbrella of Community Justice Project, so we can ask lawyers there and make sure that as you're moving forward with those steps, that you are doing it in a way that's going to best protect you should your landlord escalate to an eviction.
We got a thumbs up from Bob. And Mick, did you want to add anything to that?
Sure. I want to steer a little bit clear of giving any legal advice. And I think that Bob has summed it up pretty well. But I can tell you that cases where there's clear habitability issues in the apartment or in the rental unit can be some of the most challenging, because sometimes a landlord just doesn't have the means to fix it. Sometimes the tenant doesn't have the ability to move if it's entirely uninhabitable. And nobody wants to see a situation where someone's living someplace, oftentimes with young ones, where it is entirely uninhabitable from a legal standpoint. One thing I would say, though, is that earlier I referenced kind of this incredible matrix of support organizations that has developed since the beginning of the pandemic. Ms. Lacombe indexed them for everybody, and everybody's going to be able to reference those. But one thing that I wanted to note is that your typical community-based organization that has always been part of your neighborhood. In our area, we have Lawrenceville United, we have Morningside Area Community Council, we have Bloomfield Garfield Corporation, Bloomfield Development Corporation. These are your community-based organizations that typically handle neighborhood stuff, but they haven't had a great deal of capacity as the landlord tenant in the past. Right now, these CBOs are now all connected to this amazing network that you've learned so much about tonight. So I would definitely encourage folks to reach out to your CBOs. They have a lot of institutional knowledge about the neighborhood just from having been there a long time. And now they have connections throughout the region to eviction prevention resources. And that would be a good step to take in a situation where you don't know what to do and you believe that your property might not be habitable.
Great, thank you. I know we get that question quite a bit. It is a little past 8, so I just wanna give everyone the opportunity to offer any closing thoughts and we'll wrap up for the evening.
These times are hard. You're not alone. There are a lot of us working really, really, really hard to do as much as we can for our neighbors who are really getting some of the sharper ends of this stick. Please don't be afraid to reach out.
Call Rent Help PGH. That's my final thought.
Wonderful.
Well, I just want to thank everybody again, Representative Innamorato, for your leadership in hosting this very important event. There's been so much described and so much said that I'll just refer people to what's already been discussed. And now that this is up on Facebook and it's going to be available to the community, it's going to be a tremendous resource. Don't estimate the power of trying to work it out. A lot of folks have been doing that. And you can continue to do so with an abundance of resources that you learned about tonight.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Ms. Carroll on Facebook reminded us all to document everything. So if you are living in unsafe conditions, make sure that you're taking a lot of pictures and documenting everything. With that, thank you all. Thank you so much to our panelists for being here this evening and providing us with a bevy of information. I know it's a lot to digest, but there are so many people here to help and to answer questions. There's no such thing as a stupid question, especially when we're trying to navigate something for the first time, especially something that's so difficult as getting help and being able to stay in our homes. So thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Thank you again to our panelists, and you know, reach out if you have any questions or concerns. We're always here to listen and to connect to resources. So have a good night, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.